Hello students, welcome to the class on meetings. The objective of this session is to orient you towards the various types of meeting as per the Companies Act of 2013. So let's first begin with introduction. Meetings are part of our day-to-day life. We all attend meetings for wide variety of reasons and interests. It could be work, personal interest, or any other allied activities. Most of us take part in meeting during some point of time in our lives, while some of them do it on a regular basis. Meetings in organizations are part of day-to-day activities which facilitates decision making at various levels. Students, Companies Act of 2013 has prescribed various meetings which needs to be conveyed along with the various rules and guidelines which are regarding holding these meetings. The pictorial representation of various types of company meetings is displayed on the screen. Here, company meetings basically are of three types. They are shareholders meeting, directors meeting, and creditors meeting. Further, shareholders meetings are further subclassified into the statutory meeting, the annual general meeting, the extraordinary general meeting, and the class meeting. While in case of directors meeting, they are subclassified into board meetings and meetings of the various committees of the board. While considering creditors meeting, they are further subclassified into meetings of the debenture holders, meetings of the creditors for winding up and other than winding up, and meeting of contributories in this winding up process. Students, now the platform is apt to discuss various types of meeting in further detail. Let us first begin with statutory meetings. The statutory meeting is the first meeting of the members of the company after it commences its business. It is held only once in the entire lifetime of the company. Section 157, subsection 1 of the Companies Act states that every company limited by shares and every company limited by guarantee and having a share capital shall, within a period of not less than 3 months nor more than 6 months from the date at which the company is entitled to commence its business, hold a general meeting of the members of the company, which shall be called as the statutory meeting. Students, in this meeting, the members are to discuss a report by the directors, known as the statutory report, which contains particulars relating to the formation of the company. The nature of business conducted at the statutory meeting involves consideration and adoption of the statutory report. The statutory report is drafted by the directors and certified as correct by at least two of them. A copy of this report must be sent to every member at least 21 days before the date of this meeting. A copy of this is also to be sent to the registrar of companies for registration. Annual general meeting. Annual general meetings are opportunities for shareholders to exercise their powers of control. Holding an annual general meeting is mandatory. Such meetings should be held in every calendar year. Objects and importance of annual general meeting. Students, one of the objects of annual general meeting is to protect the interests of the shareholders. Hence, it would be better if these members meet at least once every year to review the working of the company. Appointment of auditors are also made at the annual general meetings. Students, annual accounts, which are required to be presented before the shareholders at the annual general meeting. Dividends are also declared at such meetings. Retirements and re-election of the directors take place only at annual general meeting. The meeting is the forum where the shareholders can express their views before the management and even ask for certain clarifications about the matters which may not have convinced them. As per Section 96 of Companies Act, every company other than a one-person company shall in every year hold, in addition to any other meetings, a general meeting as its annual general meeting, and shall specify the meeting as such in the notices calling it. And first AGM, that is annual general meeting, shall be held within a period of 9 months from the date of closing of the first financial year, and in all other cases within 6 months. Also, the gap between two AGMs should not be more than 15 months, provided also that registrar of companies may, for any special reason, extend the time within which any annual general meeting other than the first annual general meeting shall be held by a period not exceeding 3 months of time. Students, every annual general meeting shall be called during business hours only, that is between 9 a.m. and 6 p.m. on any day that is not a national holiday, and shall be held either at the registered office of the company or at some other place within the same city, town or village in which the registered office of the company is situated. However, central government may exempt any company from the provisions of this subsection subject to such conditions as it may impose. However, Section 97 and Section 98 of the Companies Act says, in case of default in holding AGM, tribunal may call AGM on application of any member of the company or suo motu and give ancillary directions as it may think convenient, which may also include that one member can present in person or by proxy shall constitute the quorum who would be entitled to vote at the meeting. Students, if default is made in holding a meeting of a company in accordance with these sections, the company and every officer of the company who is in default shall be punishable with a fine up to rupees 1 lakh, and in case of continuing default, with a further fine up to rupees 5,000 for every day after the first during which such default continues. Let us now come and discuss notice of the meeting. Students, a general meeting of a company may be called upon by giving not less than clear 21 days notice, either in writing or electronic mode as prescribed. Students, notice should clearly specify the date, place and day of meeting, and should also contain a statement of business to be transacted in such meetings. Notice is to be given to every member of the company, legal representative of the deceased or insolvent members, auditor, auditors of the company and every director of the company. Let us now discuss quorum. In case of public companies, as on the date of meeting, 5 members personally present if the number of members are not more than 1000, 15 members personally present if number of members are more than 1000 but up to 5000, 30 members personally present if the number of members are more than 5000. In case of private companies, 2 members personally present shall be the quorum for a meeting of the company. Students, let us now discuss the extraordinary general meeting. It is also called as EOGM or EGM. A statutory meeting and annual general meeting of a company may be called as ordinary meetings. Therefore, any other general meetings except the statutory and annual general meetings are called as extraordinary general meeting, that is EOGM. As far as extraordinary meeting is concerned, it can be called at any time when the matter to discuss is urgent and cannot wait till the next annual general meeting. In short, it is the general meeting of a company which is held between two consecutive annual general meetings for transacting special or urgent businesses. Let us now see procedure of calling extraordinary general meeting. Extraordinary general meetings may be called in the listed circumstances. Calling of the EGM by the board on its own motion. Calling of the EGM by any director of the company. Calling of EGM by the board of requisition of members as per the provisions of the act. Calling of EGM by the requisitionists themselves. And calling of EGM by the company law board or company law tribunal. Students, Companies Act of 2013 prescribes that all businesses that are considered in EGM are considered as special businesses. The functions of EGM are two-folded. First, EGM is to inform members about certain important matters pertaining to the company and, if necessary, make them attend the meetings personally wherever possible. Second point, EGM places a duty on the company to provide the shareholders more information about the businesses to be transacted at the EGM in form of explanatory statements. Further, EGM can be conveyed upon the requisition of members whether having share capital or not. However, the requisition needs signature of at least 1/10 holders of paid up share capital of the company. This requisition needs to be submitted at least 21 days prior to the proposed date of EGM. If the company fails to proceed within these 21 days and call meeting within next 45 days, then members may call themselves a meeting within a period of 3 months. Students, let us now discuss class meetings. The class meetings are ordinarily conducted to pass resolutions which would bind only the members of the class which is concerned. Such meetings will be attended by only the members of that particular class. Let's take an example, members of preference shareholders. A company calls such meetings when it is proposed to vary the right of a particular class of the shares, and it is not possible to get the consent in writing of the 3/4 of the issued shares of that class. Students, these meetings is ordinarily called class meetings. The resolutions to be passed in this meeting must be passed as special resolutions only. In case of any class of shareholders, curtailment of rights is to take place, the consent of such class or classes is necessary. Students, let us now discuss the concept of board meetings. We know the management of the company is vested in the hands of board of directors, and the directors have to act at the board meetings. The board of directors will have to function by taking decisions correctively through passing resolutions made in the meetings of the board. A company, therefore, has to function through its board of directors and or such acts and functions to be exercised by the board must be in consonance with the Act of Companies Act. Provisions of the articles and resolutions which are passed by the company in all general meetings. The listed mentioned arrangement ensures that the collective wisdom of the board is available to the company on various important decisions, and it further ensures that the decisions are taken after due deliberation and discussions among the directors of the board. Hence, the board meetings are very important for running the company so as to constitute valid decisions of a board meeting. It is further necessary that such meetings must have been conveyed by a proper authority, by a proper notice, with a proper quorum, and under the chairmanship of a proper person. Students, as per Section 173 of the Companies Act of 2013, every company shall hold the first meeting of the board of directors within 30 days of the date of its incorporation, and thereafter hold minimum number of 4 meetings of the board of directors every year in such a manner that not more than 120 days shall intervene between two consecutive meetings of the board. And any officer who is liable to send the notices fails to do so is liable for a penalty of 25,000 rupees. Students, a one-person company, small company and a dormant company shall be deemed to have complied with the provisions of these sections if at least one meeting of the board of directors has been conducted in each half of the calendar year and the gap between the two meetings is not less than 90 days. Let us now discuss quorum for these meetings. The quorum for a meeting of board of directors of a company shall be one-third, that is 33% of the total strength or two directors, whichever is higher. Students, suppose if the meeting can't be held for want of quorum, then meeting shall automatically stand adjourned to the same day at the same time and the place in the next week. While the Companies Act of 2013 have further mandated for certain mandatory committees, their thresholds and compositions in the board. These committees are Audit Committee, Nomination and Remuneration Committee, Stakeholders Relationship Committee and Corporate Social Responsibility Committee. Students, board members are part of these committees. The Companies Act of 2013 have further clarified the composition, nature of work and meeting requirements for these committees. Students, let us now discuss next type of meetings, that is creditors and contributories meeting. These meetings are called when the company proposes to make a scheme of arrangement with its creditors. The court may order a meeting of the creditors or a class of creditors on the application of the company or on the application of liquidator in case of a company is being wound up. Such meetings is held and conducted in such a manner as the court directs. If an arrangement is passed by a majority of 3/4 in value of the creditors and the same is sanctioned by the court, it is binding in on all the creditors of the company. Further, these meetings are held when the company has gone into liquidation to ascertain the total amount which is due by the company to its creditors. Students, the main purpose of these meetings is to obtain the approval of the creditors and contributories to the scheme of compromise or rearrangement to save the company from any financial difficulties. Sometimes, the court may also order for such a meeting to be held. When a company desires to vary the rights of debenture holders, such meetings are to be held according to the rules which are laid down in the debenture trust deeds. Further, they are also to be held to enable the company to issue any new debentures or to vary the rate of interest payable to these debenture holders. Students, the term contributory covers every person who is liable to contribute to the assets of the company when the company is in process of being wound up. Meetings of debenture holders. Students, these meetings are called according to the rules and regulations of the trust deed or debenture bonds. Such meetings are held from time to time where the interest of debenture holders are involved at the time of reorganization, reconstruction, amalgamation or winding up of the company. The rules regarding the appointment of chairman, notice of the meeting, quorum, etc. are contained in the trust deed itself. Coming to the conclusion part, students, with this I would like to conclude by mentioning that we have finished discussing about the concept of meeting. We have also discussed various types of meeting as per the Companies Act of 2013. With this, I would like to conclude this session. Thank you.